everyone. Thanks for joining us on our LinkedIn Live event. Today, we'll be discussing upskilling your engineering career. I'm Craig Coffey, Content Strategy and Marketing Manager for Brightlayer at Eaton, and I'll be moderating our session today. Just a reminder, you are not required to click on any links during this event. If you're seeing me, you're in the right place. And aside from commenting or asking questions, we will not be asking you to click on any links. For those of you joining today who are not familiar with Eaton, we are a diversified industrial manufacturer, but we identify as an intelligent power management company. Our engineering team at Eaton is a highly valued global community of nearly 10,000 engineering professionals working in technology domains like power electronics, energy systems, material services, additive manufacturing, industry 4.0, digital technologies, and cybersecurity. Our engineers are working every day on technologies to make our world more sustainable, doing our part to help protect the future of our planet. Today, we're going to discuss how engineers can upskill and unlock a variety of career paths. Our panelists will share their experiences and provide advice on how to grow your engineering career. We welcome all of your questions and hope to address as many as possible. With me today, I have an amazing panel of engineering leaders from around the world. Would you each take a couple minutes to introduce yourselves? Kelly, let's start with you.
Yeah, thank you, Craig. I'm Kelly Williams, and I'm the engineering director for Eaton Aerospace. My team is responsible for design engineering for the full product lifecycle. So we support current products out in the field. We support new product introduction and new product development, as well as future organic growth through R&D. And I've been at Eaton for 15 years, and I'm located in Jackson, Michigan.
Hi, my name is Mark Kelly. I lead the Center for Intelligent Power. And in the Center for Intelligent Power, we focus on data science, and machine learning, and artificial intelligence. And in particular, we're focused on how do we use artificial intelligence and machine learning to make our products and services more responsive, more adaptive to our customers' needs. I'm based in Dublin in Ireland, and I'm with Eaton about 4.5 years and loving it.
Hi, everyone. I'm Pradeep. I lead the digital engineering team in EIIC, Eaton India Innovation Center. I have been with Eaton for just 4 months now, but I have been loving every moment I have been here. My team is responsible for building platforms, propositions, and building analytics and algorithms, what Mark Kelly said. So it's a fantastic team doing great work to make Eaton a real intelligent power company. Glad to be here.
Thanks, everybody. Again, if you weren't here for the beginning of our intro, we are starting to see some spam introduced on LinkedIn Live in the comments. We are not going to be asking you guys to click on any links. If you're seeing us, then you're in the right place, and don't click any links that you see in the comments. As the least credentialed person in this panel, I'm really excited for our discussion today, and I really want it to be that. I want it to be a discussion. So please submit your questions using the comment section, and we'll do our best to respond to as many as we can. For our first question, just to tee things up, I'll ask the panel this. In today's world, what are the most valuable skills that engineers need to have? And if they don't possess those skills, what do they need to do? Kelly, you want to field the first one?
Sure. Yeah, it's a great question. I think for me in the aerospace industry, I can say we are very familiar with lots and lots of data. I mean, that's part of our industry and certification. We have long product life cycles. So what I've been seeing is more and more interest in data analytics and looking at what do we do with all this data that we have been collecting over the years, as well as future data that we would like to start collecting in order to better design our products for our customers. So that could be prognostics and health monitoring, real-time support in the field. So for me, I think data analytics is becoming more and more popular, and there's a bigger and bigger need as just the world becomes more digital.
Mark?
Yeah, so I'm obviously very happy to hear Kelly say that.
You're welcome.
Good career choices. For me, I don't disagree what Kelly said, but when I think of the skill for a technologist or an engineer, I really think about critical thinking and the importance of critical thinking. And no matter what the discipline you have in engineering, should be a foundation or a basis of how you think through problems. And there's lots of ways, there's lots of techniques you can use critical critical thinking. Oftentimes the best way is really on the job. But, you know, that ability to be able to ask really good questions. And, you know, I like to think that you're continuously over your life trying to become better at asking questions to get to the essence. We have different techniques, you know, over the years I've learned, the bottom hats and nine whys, all of these things really, really help. But if I was to give one piece of, you know, advice and one skill that I think is critical for an engineering career, it's critical thinking.
Pradeep, what are your thoughts?
Thank you, Kumar. In my view, there are two skills that as engineers we need to develop, which we probably don't learn in our engineering schools. One is empathy. You got to understand what your customer needs are. One needs to wear the shoes of the customer and think backwards. Let's not do the job left to right, but right to left. This is extremely critical as you move up the value chain, understand the customer needs, develop solutions for that. The second, again, is storytelling. As engineers, as we move up, we got to convince people who don't understand engineering. We need to practice the lingo of the business leaders who don't come from the same background like all of us come. So storytelling is extremely important. We got to sell our ideas internally. So these two things, empathy and storytelling, in my view, are extremely important to build a successful engineering career.
Those are all great comments. I appreciate the thoughts there. At Eaton, one of our employee value propositions is we make your growth matter. How have you seen Eaton encourage employees to upskill careers? And I'll start with Kelly on that one.
Sure. Yeah, I would say, you know, as an engineering manager, one of the things that we spend a lot of time on is development plans. So we do our goal setting and we understand tactically what it is we want to accomplish, but we spend just the equal amount of time in understanding what an individual needs to also achieve in order to be ready for their next career move or even to be able to support the work that they're doing in their current role. And it's, so as a manager, we spend a lot of time meeting on a regular cadence, like monthly, with an individual to say, you know, what is it that you're looking for? What kind of learning do you need? How can we best support you? And that can be a class that they're taking. It could be a book that they're reading, or it could be a stretch assignment that we've given for them to be able to get an experience. So, you know, for me, I've seen Eaton do that really well. And I think, you know, I've seen my team, my managers doing that really well. So I think that's been a great opportunity. The other thing I would say is mentoring. We have a really strong mentoring program, and I've been fortunate enough at Eaton to be a mentor through that program for quite a few years. And so that's been really great to give some cross-business, cross-divisional connections and relationships. So you have a network that's even outside of the business that you're in. So those are two great things I've seen.
Yeah, I'd probably add, I think Eaton takes training and development very seriously. It's a core part of almost the ethos, what we would call the Eaton business system. Being a learner is something that we really value and we really encourage. And the in terms of opportunities, we have loads of really great courses and loads of great kind of online materials we're able to use. But we also have an enviable amount of subject matter experts in this company that are always very willing and able to share that information through, for instance, the mentoring programs Kelly mentioned. One other thing that I think is fantastic, and I was lucky this week to be out in our in the innovation center in India with Pradeep, and Eaton gives a great opportunity for engineers to be able to move around and experience different opportunities in different roles, and that is fairly amazing actually. So you can actually take your skills or grow your skills. You can kind of grow laterally. You can kind of learn new areas, new parts of the business, and it's all here and capable of being able to do that. And that's a phenomenal capability we have. Quite enviable in some ways, as I was looking at some of the kind of the playground of technologies that people can get to interact with.
Thank you, Mark. This is typical of industry. Learning is 70-20-10. We follow the same philosophy in Eaton as well. 70 is on the job, all of us learn. 20 is through learning from trainings and 10 is through learning from colleagues, right? So we have the same philosophy at Eaton itself. Just about the training that we have specifically at Eaton India Innovation Center is we have two paths, technical path and leadership path. On the technical path, we have Skill Lab, which is essentially for the mid-level career people, equip talent to be future ready through customized learning curriculum for technology domains. It could be digital domains or deep in electrical or mechanical. Beacon, this is an enrichment experience for seasoned technical talent. As you move up, learning never stops, right? So that's as well there. And if you take the leadership path, we start off with young emerging leaders. The program is called FEEL, Fueling Eaton's Emerging Leaders. That's the program. As you grow up, first-time manager, and there is a nice program called Stand Tall. This is all for the development experience for women leaders to gain exposure and emerge as really inspirational engineering leaders, right? As you move up, Axel is another program. This is like building thought leadership, right? It's not just I'm an expert in the domain, but I got to be an expert in the domain across the industry. So this is kind of a program. So there is enormous amount of learning opportunities that exist in Eaton, and it's phenomenal that I experienced this already in the first 4 months.
Yeah, from my standpoint, I think it's great to see such evidence that Eaton's really thought this through, not just about how we get people into the door, but how we keep them with Eaton and make their career challenging and exciting throughout. We're starting to get some questions from the audience. I do want to remind everyone who's on the LinkedIn Live to please submit your questions via the comment section, and we'll try and field as many as we can. I'm going to right now expose myself as a non-engineer. We got a question from Usama who's asking, how valuable would a PMP be for an engineering professional? Any ideas? I actually had to go back and ask what a PMP was. Now I was educated to find out that it's a project management professional certification. Thank you to our moderators for helping me be smarter in front of all of you. Who wants to share some thoughts on that?
I can take that. I have done program management for 12 years of my 25 years of career, right? Certifications are good, but it has a place. Potentially, it can open some doors of opportunities, but that's not enough, guys. For me, you got to understand this as you learn. You get experiential learning is extremely important. These books can teach you as to how to do risk management. You can write a risk register and whatnot. But when you are asked to find out the risks in the program, it's extremely difficult. It only comes with practice. So good to have certification, but that's not be all end all, and that doesn't certify glory anyway. It's just an entry point. Good to have it, but really, really, you have to practice it. That would be my piece of advice.
Anyone else any thoughts?
Yeah, I think, you know, it's definitely a path within engineering that's very, very important, you know, the project management professional. There's other pathways through. Some people will stay very, very deep technical, you know, and really immerse themselves in kind of core parts of the technology. That's a very valid career path as well. And we have pathways through the company for like senior technical leaders as well. And then people sometimes move towards the general management or the manager or leader of people path as well. And all of those are kind of open pathways inside the company. And it oftentimes depends on then personal preference and what affinity you have to each one of them roles. But I think they're all important roles in the world of engineering, of course.
Kelly, thoughts on PMP?
Yeah, I think I would say the same. You know, I think in the process of getting a PMP certification, you certainly would learn a lot of valuable information about the types of tools and processes that would go into, you know, execution. So I think it's always great to be learning. I think as far as is a certification going to be able to help you move through your engineering career, I wouldn't say that it would be something I think is required or necessary. Unless, you know, I think, as Mark is saying, right, depending on where you want to go with your career, if you're looking for other opportunities outside of just a technical engineering domain, then sure, that might be one of the steps that you need to take in order to be able to get where you want to be next.
Great. We are starting to see a lot of questions coming in, and apparently a lot of questions are coming in related to how to join Eaton, which is really gratifying. Just as a reminder, at the end of this LinkedIn Live, we will share a slide that shows you the path to our careers website. So stay tuned for that. But in the meantime, we're going to go to another question from the audience. Apologies for any mispronunciation of names here, but this is from Ishan Wah. With the increasing trends of everything going digital and cloud and electrical and electronics, et cetera, how can the mechanical engineer cope with those changes? What major areas do mechanical engineers need to concentrate on in non-mechanical areas to go up the ladder? Sounds like how can these mechanical engineers make the transition to maybe, you know, cope with the digital transformation issues that we're experiencing? Sure. I'm going to point that one to Mark, actually.
A tough one, but I'll do my best. I don't necessarily think if you're a mechanical mechanical engineering isn't going away. If you think of a lot of the, particularly in a company like Eaton in the area that Kelly works in vehicle, I think what tends to happen, right, is the way in which we then use that information or the tools we use, I think, are changing and evolving. So you're, for example, seeing a lot more, you know, data analytics, a lot more analysis being done on the data. I don't know if the nature of the role will continue to evolve, but if you have skills and competency in mechanical engineering, that doesn't all of a sudden become an invaluable part of engineering. And, you know, the world in which we inhabit is still very much, you know, call it cyber physical, still very much combined with digital. So maybe extending some digital skills on top of your mechanical skills, even being able to do things like scripting and be able to work with data is very, very useful. I think you'll see the kind of combination of, say, physics-based models and data-driven models becoming something very, very powerful for a mechanical engineer going forward, using, you know, tools like artificial intelligence as well with mechanical engineering. So I think you'll see some of the synthesis going on. But for that particular questionnaire, if you've invested your time and effort, you have very valuable skills and you should look to build upon them, add to them, and not necessarily move to work away. Of course, it's a personal choice. But my advice would be to look at what could you add on there in areas like, you know, analytics. I think that Kelly mentioned earlier on, mm-hmm. Of course, a topic near and dear to my heart. But it would be important to kind of extend your skill set and broaden your base, perhaps.
Yeah.
Anyone else comment?
I would add to that too. I mean, I was thinking the same thing. I don't think that digitalization or data analytics is limited to a particular discipline. I think it's a tool set that we can use to be able to do all of our jobs better. And as you know, Mark said, we certainly have a need for mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, software, firmware, hardware. I mean, those diverse skill sets is what enables us to launch a product. It is not just a purely a mechanical product or an electrical product. It's a cross-functional, cross-expertise team that would be successful. So I think I have plenty of mechanical engineers that are learning new software tools, learning how to automate design, analysis. I mean, there's a ton of opportunities in order to be able to maybe work more efficiently using tools that we have, no matter what your discipline is.
It looks like we've got a couple of questions from the audience related to design engineering. So, and one was specifically put to Kelly, so I'll let her start with this. Question from Profala: what will the future of design engineering be in an organization like Eaton? And a similar question, can you discuss some of the most promising and emerging technologies in the design engineering field and the skills required to work with them effectively?
Yeah, okay. Those are two good questions. Let's see. So the first one, if I think about future for design engineering, where things are going, and I mean, I talked a little bit about automation and how to improve our efficiency and our turnaround time and design. I think the other area we're doing a lot of is, you know, how do we do like model-based systems engineering? So it's more, how do we link a model that we do with the analysis that we do with the test results from the hardware so that we're kind of in a continuous iterating loop? So it's that digital thread connecting all of the data at the different points in the development cycle. So I think, you know, that's something that we're working on now is how do we better leverage those connection points and the tools that are becoming available today. So that's certainly where I see the future going. As far as the future for, you know, what are some exciting things that are happening in aerospace? It's actually a really exciting time in aerospace right now. We're where a vehicle was 10, 20 years ago as far as electrification. So we're seeing more and more desire for electric propulsion. So how do we get away from traditional fossil fuels? So there's hybrid technologies, all electric technologies. So that's really changing the way that we design an aircraft and aircraft systems. So I think that's been really exciting to see. And then, of course, there's always a big need for sustainability, so more sustainable fuels, biofuels. You know, that's another area where we see a big trend in aerospace.
That's great. Pradeep, any thoughts there?
In terms of design, I mean, the other context is, of course, there's digital design, industrial design. Eaton has a lot of scope. I mean, if the question was what opportunities Eaton has, we provide a lot of scope for such work. Building customer experiences is extremely important. Yesterday, myself or Mark were in a leadership event wherein this came out very pronouncedly. But end of the day, how does the customer experience our product or solution? That's becoming very important, which means the design folks have a very important role to play there, right? It's not just thumping a solution out there and the customer takes like 40 steps to get to the solution. How can I get it very easily? So this is extremely important. And so is the industrial design. It has changed like significantly in any product design you do. So design element is coming in everything that you do, even in the big switch gears that we do. I mean, from there to residential products that we do, design is a very significant element. And we pay a lot of attention in Eaton for this, both industrial design and digital design.
Let's shift gears a little bit.
Yeah, I'd add actually just onto that. I think design is one of the most exciting areas where you're starting to see the emergence of technologies. So some of the applications I think I fully agree with. But for example, we're looking at how we can design products using artificial intelligence and machine learning and combining that with what might be called physics-based models with more black-based models or data-driven models. You know, areas like evolutionary algorithms, where you're actually able to take a design and run it through multiple different parameters, effectively just purely in a computational mode. So that means you're running these designs and these models on computers, and you could be running hundreds, if not thousands, of these models simultaneously. If you think about being a product designer, what it normally took to design a system or design a part or a piece, that could have taken what could be now run in the orders of hours and minutes. Would have taken weeks and months. And this is permeating every single part of, you know, different types of industries, whether that's in how we design hardware, you know, really kind of complex metal structures, right, what we put in airplanes, or how we design, you know, PCB boards, or even then how we, you know, design networks, or how we lay out, you know, grids for, you know, the utilities business. Every part of our business, we're seeing an emergence of and an acceleration towards artificial intelligence to speed up and work with humans to basically enable us, you know, reason through things and, you know, make decisions faster.
So shifting gears a little bit, we're starting to see some questions that look like they're more related to kind of the soft skills that an engineer needs in an organization like Eaton. So here's a question. How do you effectively network within an organization, and what should the end goal be? It's often perceived as an individual reaching out to high-level leadership, but is it as simple as that? High-level folks like people on this panel are probably too busy to entertain the multiple requests they would get from junior-level employees. So what would your best advice be about networking, maybe from your experience?
I guess I want to say first that that's not true. I'm never too busy to be have people reaching out to me. Actually, I think that is one component of my job. That is actually my job, is to help develop and mentor people. So, I mean, I just wanted to catch that right away, right? That isn't the case. I think, you know, sometimes it can be as simple as just reaching out to someone, but I think it works best when people are thoughtful about why they want to reach out to someone. So sometimes you might reach out to someone in my position because you're interested in, you know, that next career step. But there's other reasons why you might want to reach out to someone. Like, I might want to reach out to Mark because I'm interested in understanding some of the tools that they're using, right? I may not want to be, you know, in that domain, but there's things I want to learn from him. So I think if you think about why you want to connect with someone and for what reasons, I think that really helps facilitate those connections and relationships. So that would be one piece of advice I would have.
Yeah, when we think about building our network, it shouldn't just be we think of our network as a kind of an upwardly system. And the way I sometimes think of a network is you build it in every single direction, up and down. And I would like to think I do the very same thing today. And the same notion, right? I think it's a core part of your job to basically work with up and down the organization and not just someone that you think is your peer or someone that's your boss or more senior than you. And I would encourage everybody, if you're thinking about a career, to build your network like a spiral up and down. Because what that tends to do is leads to new opportunities, leads to new relationships. And oftentimes, every relationship you have, it shouldn't just be this idea of being transactional. Sometimes having a relationship with someone in work is just about learning from them or getting a different set of perspective. So when you think about building your network, I would think about building it broadly and building it widely. And, you know, learning, there's, for example, when I joined Eaton, I'll use an example, I made it my business to try and understand the business of Eaton. It's such a large, diversified company. I'd come from an organization that maybe made, you know, in comparison to Eaton, very few products. And so I had reached out to people from our finance organization to learn and, you know, to actually mentor me in some of the ways in which business gets done inside of Eaton. You know, I've learned as much from the people that are, you know, starting their careers. I learned then how they want to basically receive information. So it's never just a one-directional transactional kind of relationship. It's about sharing and giving information that, you know, I hope informs me. And on the other side of that, then I hope that I'm able to give some wisdom, or certainly maybe some lessons learned from mistakes made. It's probably a better way of saying it. And maybe other people can then avoid some of the pitfalls and the many I've made over a long career.
Yeah. Well, it just, you know, since this is a non-engineering related question, I absolutely have to echo what Mark said about not making every networking opportunity a transactional opportunity. There, I mean, that can be draining both on the networker and the networkee. I mean, there's got to be a good give and take between parties. Pretty bending down.
Yeah, I mean, I think you guys have covered it well. For me, it's a 360-degree network you got to build, like already Mark and Kelly suggested, right? So it's not, I mean, and as leaders, I mean, for me, the definition of the leader is to get the best out of people. So it's like Kelly said, it's my job to get the best out of people. So there's nothing that, I mean, at the max, you might be in a meeting, ping them back, and you got to have that. And I love to have informal conversations. Don't make it extremely formal. I mean, even in my one-on-ones with my direct reporters, hey, one-on-ones are meant for you. It is meant for the development of a person. We don't discuss about the day-to-day work. It's extremely important as leaders to have that in our mind, but because we jump into the work, hey, tell me what is the top issue on your mind. I want to know how many bucks are there in this. When is the release? Stop that. One-on-ones are not meant for that. We have different forums, right? So, like Mark said, it's experiential learning. Share. Hey, that's what I've done in my mentoring programs as well, saying, these are the mistakes I made. This is what I learned. If it makes sense to you, please learn from that, right? So,
yeah, I don't think anybody likes to see in their Outlook calendar, networking event, half hour with XYZ person. It puts a lot of pressure on everybody to kind of perform. And it's, I don't think it comes across as genuine, but I think those water cooler conversations, those cafeteria conversations are probably the place to find your way there, you know. And if I can just add one other thing, I mean, be aspirational. Look at folks in the company. I think this is mentioned by a couple of folks. Look at folks in the company that you want to be like. Try and find out as much as you can about them and their path. And if there's things you can model from there, I think that's fantastic. You're a good place to start. Specific to Eaton, I'll ask the panel this: what are some of the biggest intrinsic benefits of upskilling for an employee? I mean, we've talked a lot about that. Actually, let me shift gears on that. Instead of asking about what the benefits are to the employee, what are the benefits of upskilling to the employer? To us,
I'll take that, Craig. First of all, I think a learning and an engaged worker learning, it brings more than just better ability or capacity to do better work or more work. They bring energy, they bring engagement, they bring enthusiasm. They have a curiosity, an intellectual curiosity that is the engine room of innovation in any company. So training and development for a company is all about creating an environment, a culture of learning, a culture of innovation, and driving and propelling any company forward. And I think every employer, any company or any company that has been as successful as Eaton has been for as long as it's been, you know, it's an amazing story. It's because fundamentally what we do is we really do believe in that philosophy of training and development. And as I said, we believe in it so much inside of Eaton. We make it part of our operating system, what we would call our Eaton, you know, we have a proprietary system that we use to basically standardize a lot of our training and development and our process in our company. We believe it intrinsically in this company, and we encourage it relentlessly and use it as a characteristic of growth and development. So it's really, really important as we look for those characteristics in people as they go through their career, that they're a lifelong learner and they're always growing in development. That's, you know, it's in our DNA. It's probably the best way of saying it.
Kelly?
If I may add to what Mark said, right, from an employer perspective, while we hire people primarily looking at the hard skills is what people feel. It's not just hard skills. The ability of the person to be assimilated in the larger organization is extremely important. Otherwise, it's like organ rejection, right? You might have the greatest of hard skills, technical skills. If a person cannot gel well with the rest of the folks, gel well with the culture of the organization, organ rejection is going to happen. Doesn't matter where your IQ is. So that's a huge, huge benefit. If I have a person within Eaton who has gelled with the culture and understands the culture of Eaton, he upskills, a mechanical engineer upskills and has some data science capabilities, I would love to have him in my team, right? So that's a genuine advantage as an employer to have people upskill. So they're part of the system, they know how it works, they have an additional skill. Wow, that's brilliant.
Yeah, I think, yep, all good points. I mean, I think this the same thing. The other thing I see is, you know, with the upskilling and people learning new areas, new businesses, new, you know, technologies, I think it's an opportunity for them to help bring new knowledge to different teams too. So that cross-pollination, or somebody's learned something new, they went to a class and they're sharing it now with the larger team, or they changed roles because they had some, you know, opportunities and learned some new things and they're ready for a new role. But they still brought the learnings from that previous role, maybe some lessons learned on how things are being done somewhere else that we want to implement here. So I think it helps with that diverse thought too. So that's one of the benefits that I see, and just overall with the upskilling and, you know, the ability for people to learn.
Yeah, I'm reminded of just thinking that there's, we can think of upskilling very in a very linear path, upskilling your engineering career. But I'm reminded of I'm working with a legal professional here at Eaton who's a lawyer and also a degreed electrical engineer working on a software project. I mean, what an amazing path that's got to be, and what a value to Eaton to have that embedded in the organization. So there are opportunities, maybe even outside of engineering, for upskilling too. Just to think about that. Let's take a minute to brag about some of the things that are going on in your day-to-day lives. What are some of the really interesting projects that your teams are working on? How do they provide up opportunities to upskill? And maybe we can take an opportunity to maybe tease out some cool projects that maybe some of the people on this call will want to get involved with, or could get involved with if they join the organization.
Yeah, I can go. I think I touched on it a little bit already, just with some of the mega trends in our industry with the previous question we got. But you know, we're certainly embracing these trends with sustainability as well as electrification. So for my industry, it's been very exciting for us to be able to do things that, you know, aerospace hasn't done before. So if you think about urban air mobility and vertical lift and takeoff, like you're thinking of like Uber Air, right? That's something that's new. Like, we haven't seen that in our world yet. And so that's been really exciting for us to be a part of that. And how does Eaton play a part in that? How does engineering make sure that we have products that are ready to support these new aircraft. All of that's been really exciting, and it's certainly an opportunity for us to upskill as we're doing something that hasn't been done before.
Yeah, Kelly mentioned these mega trends that's happening in our industry, but in fact, what's so exciting being in Eaton at the moment is there's actually generational mega trends that are happening all around us, and Eaton happens to be so well positioned. If you think about electrification and you think of electric vehicles, electric airplanes, you know, more and more renewables becoming part of the way in which we, you know, are part of our homes and large factories and buildings and data centers. If you think of the sustainability challenges within the world and you think of things like digitalization, these aren't like once in a decade transformations. You're talking about a fundamental change to the likes of the electrical grid, which has pretty much been the same since Tesla and Edison, you know, were trying to wire up things in New York City. These are like generational changes that are happening, and Eaton is positioned right in the middle of it. That actually leads to, of course, a number of really, really exciting projects. You know, we're working with utilities companies and trying to model and understand their grids and optimize their grids, right, for sustainability, for how electric vehicles are going to impact and change the way in which we use power. We're working to understand how buildings can be more sustainable and meet their energy and sustainability goals, and how an intelligent power management company like Eaton is part of it. You know, we think about how we can optimize the power for electrical vehicles and distribute power safely, reliably. If those things are important, they're in areas to be exciting for you. This is the epicenter. Eaton is the epicenter of this type of work and technology. And we're very lucky, very blessed to have the opportunity to work across multiple different segments inside Eaton, because it is a diversified power management company. And in every single segment we work in, there is massive transformation, massive technological innovation all happening all at once. It's crazy, it's wild, it's exciting. It keeps you intellectually curious. It keeps you intellectually honest, because the challenges we face are absolutely enormous. So, you know, I couldn't think of a better place to be working, quite frankly.
Yeah, I mean, you guys said all that I could have said. I mean, electrification, energy transition, and digital transformation, right? These are big themes. And like Mark said beautifully, it's not a decade kind of a change. It's a generational change that we're seeing, right? And we do cool projects across. I mean, in the utility space, it is no more producer and consumer. It is prosumers, right? Everything is a grid. So you generate power, give it back to the grid. That's phenomenal. That has not happened in the past, right? We are in the middle of building such technologies to really enable such a thing, right? So there is enormous opportunity to build such data centers. I mean, these are power hoggers, right? We know everything, everybody wants to store data on the cloud. That doesn't come for cheap. Power is an extremely important element of that. So how do you ensure that we do in a sustainable way if we are in the middle of that, right? Industry is going through a massive transformation in terms of digital transformation. You want to call it Industry 4.0 or whatnot. We are in the middle of that. So you name it, the coolest thing that is happening in all these three spaces, we are in the middle of it and really cutting edge. If somebody says that, hey, I know the path to get there, I really don't believe, because we know what our OnStar is. We are figuring out in a very, very agile fashion, pivoting every other day or I mean, I don't know how many times, because we got to get there. But this is really new and really cutting edge. So it's super exciting. I'm learning every day in the last 4 months, that I can promise.
So it's funny. Thank you to the commenters who continue to ask questions, because I think they're writing my script for me here. This is interesting. So we've spent a lot of time talking about energy transition and the digital transformation that's going on around us. And there's no denying that's going on. But this question from Josiah, I think, is interesting. I mean, we still make stuff. So the question is, the focus seems to be on digital design and engineering, but nothing is created without manufacturing engineers. What place is there for manufacturing engineers at Eaton?
Yeah, I think, you know, I would say, you know, Pradeep touched on it, right? When you talked about Factory 4.0, I mean, we're talking about smart manufacturing. So for us, we're looking at how do we take the way that we do things now and make them more efficient? How do we improve our quality by automation? And it's things like, can you have a bench that knows from the model, from design engineering, how much torque we need to apply to this bolt? And then the torque wrench measures, yeah, they've achieved that much torque and it shuts off, right? I mean, I think there's a lot of exciting things that are happening as far as manufacturing and that future industry. So yeah, certainly.
I would have to say, first of all, we make a lot of stuff in Eaton, a lot of assets. We make a lot of stuff. Manufacturing engineering is, like many jobs, going to go and change, but equally, manufacturing engineering, Kelly touched on, is incredibly exciting space. But the very nature of the way we manufacture things is changing with the likes of additive manufacturing. The very way in which we're able to monitor, manage, optimize processes is being enabled by IoT technologies. Manufacturing engineering will still and remain critical. We're moving from in different industries from ours, but if you think of moving from kind of mass production to mass customization, manufacturing engineering has gone through a radical transformation equally. And I would think, as an engineer, it's an equally exciting place to be in, because we are going to be continuously challenged by new materials, new ways of manufacturing, new processes, increased automation. It seems incredibly exciting to me. I would not be unhappy if I had chosen the manufacturing career path to be in this space at this time.
No, I completely concur with what you guys said, right? I mean, IIoT, if you want to call it, I mean, IoT is getting more and more syllables nowadays. Right? So this is that's cool thing, right? So you got to monitor what's happening. Once you monitor, you have to collect the data, then have actionable insights after that, improve the process. That's in simple four phrases, I would say, the cool thing that's happening in manufacturing. So it's super exciting. I mean, it's changing. It's no more old school, and it improves. I mean, the assembly lines are changing as we speak. And we at Eaton are in the middle of that as well. With all the 200 plus factories that we have this as a key point.
Yeah, without a doubt, we're facing a generational shift when it comes to manufacturing, and it's imperative that we get smarter with the deployment of human capital when it comes to manufacturing. And I think that's right in the sweet spot for engineering. Let's shift gears a second here. Question from Lenka. What is the biggest challenge you've had to face in your engineering career so far? And in what way has it affected your upskilling or not? Mark, I see you nodding pensively.
I'm going through the book of many failures. Being honest, I've had my fair share of failures, and what I've tried to do with them is accept that that's failure is much as part of success as the wins, because it's the lessons you learn from it, and it's your willingness to learn from the lessons, to be able to do a piece of what you call introspection and learn from them. In my recent times, if I'm being honest, I made some errors around underestimating a problem and overestimating my ability to get it done, maybe me and my teams. And that's a hard lesson, because sometimes what you end up happening, I think we ended up shipping the product, but not without cost. It was cost because we all had to work harder, work later, work weekends. And that takes a toll on people, and particularly the family. So the lesson from that, right, was a touch of humility and better planning. And all of the times, every time I've made a mistake, what I've tried to do is take that learning and put that learning into a kind of a teachable principle or a teachable point of view. I make sure it becomes part of the Mark Kelly operating system. We literally have to play my greatest hits of failures, and there's been many of them. But you make them consistently. You try not to make sure to mitigate the risk. But the reality of being an engineer is you will make mistakes. You have to learn from them. That needs to become a part of how you accept to do your job, continuously improve. I think that's the best advice I can give any engineer in that regard, is you need to have perseverance, and you need to be willing to learn from your mistakes, own them, and be transparent, by the way, most importantly, when you make them.
I guess maybe I was thinking too, when I'm thinking about what was challenging. So of course, yeah, the work that we do is challenging. I mean, and designing something for the first time, of course, that is going to be a challenge. So there's plenty of those. I think for me too, I'm thinking about, you know, just career growth and challenges. Like I've moved around in different businesses. I actually didn't start my career in aerospace. I actually started my career in materials research. So I spent 10 years doing materials research before I moved into aerospace. And I think that was really challenging to go from an expert in my field to a completely brand new field and having to, you know, build up that technical know-how again. And, you know, I think for me, you know, I've changed divisions. I've changed product lines. I've changed teams. Every time it's a challenge is that, you know, you're drinking from the fire hose, as we say, right? It's like there's so much to learn, and it can be so exciting and overwhelming at the same time. But I mean, that's always a challenge, which I think is a good challenge. We should be challenging ourselves to do something outside of the box and make ourselves a little uncomfortable.
Thank you. In my perspective, those are real mistakes which I made and learned, right? Keeping quality at the center and paramount importance of anything and everything we do. At times we forget that, hey, it's okay, we might have some bugs, right? I mean, many people from the software community are on the show, I suppose, right? How many times we feel, this can be technical debt, let me ship it out, right? So that is going to bite us back really hard. I learned it. I mean, in a few of the products where I went and signed off saying, it's okay, let there be remaining bugs, it bit us really bad. So for me, from those experiences, I can tell you, it takes a long time to recover. It can impact the brand. Once it impacts the brand, your market share comes down, right? So never, ever compromise on quality. From day one, as a software engineer, if you're starting from day one, ensure that your negative test cases work. Positive test cases, everybody can call for. Ensure that you practice that from the very beginning. That's one great learning I've had in my life. After that, I never compromise on quality. For me, quality is the centerpiece of anything and everything we do. Quality is not just about the code you generate. When you write an email, think twice, think thrice before sending an email. Is it right? Does it have the right intention? Quality in anything and everything we do is paramount importance to, I mean, that's the brand. Like Mark said, Mark Operatings, that is the Pradeep brand, right? So I don't want to be seen in negative, in a negative way by anything I do. So quality should be the centerpiece of anything and everything we do. That's my biggest learning.
Great advice, everybody. Here's something from our content team. So according to a survey by Epignosis Talent LMS, 36% of Gen Z workers are not satisfied with how well their education prepared them for the workplace. What is Eaton doing to address the skills gap in our industry? Pradeep, why don't we start with you?
Sure. I'm surprised it's just 36%. I thought it could be much higher. But indeed, what we learn in school and what we do at work, when it comes to the industry, it's a huge gap. Right. At Eaton, we do have programs where we tie up with universities so that we make them industry ready. Right. So there are programs not just in India, across the world, where Eaton has tied up with universities so that we get undergrads or grads who come out of school ready for the industry. Even after they come on board, there is a very good onboarding process through which we take, hey, this is what you have learned in school, but this is what is expected in the industry, right? It's not, I mean, for example, all of us learn programming in school nowadays, right? So here, don't start with programming. Try to understand the why, the what, and the how. Me and Mark were in a beautiful debate today in the morning, understanding the what. Don't jump into the how. It's extremely important. I think there are programs where we try to inculcate these kind of learnings to new fresh grads who come out of school so that you learn this, understand the what, then jump to. I mean, coding for me is clerical, don't get me wrong, it's just translation, but getting the what, why am I coding for what, is extremely important. That's what I think at Eaton we have beautiful programs which help engineers to become really productive in the industry?
Yeah, we some of the techniques we've used, and I think they're quite powerful, call it a mentor or a buddy system. Oftentimes when we have a young graduate coming in, we'll mentor them up. And even if they're, you know, postgraduate or they have, you know, advanced degrees and so on, we'll still not assume anything, right? We'll assume that what they have is a good theoretical grounding. And what we want to be able to do is balance that with my grounding or practitioner-based training. And the best way to do that, in my view, is, you know, on the job, is working through challenges and issues. But I give stretching people enough that you're keeping them moving, you're keeping them learning, but not enough that they're getting stressed, particularly as people are starting off their career. You kind of want them, what sometimes referred to as in that zone of psychological safety. So they're learning and they're growing, but at the same time, we're not putting undue pressure. And we're very mindful of that. That's something we want people to be growing and developing, not being under total stress. And we will then pace the work according to the individual capabilities and individual talents. So it's not a one size fit all. There's some people that will sometimes take a little longer to get going, learning processes. There's some that will take to it like a duck to water. And what you always try and do is tailor that to the individual and be very mindful of that. So that's something we spend a bit of time is, you know, mentoring and developing people in that way. And trying then to tailor, you know, their development according to their talents and the kind of rate at which they're working as well. Because we all learn, you know, kind of at slightly different ways, and we all have different ways of kind of learning. So you need to be mindful of that, I think, when you're bringing on particularly kind of graduates and engineers that are maybe early in their career.
Yeah, I guess I would say too, I'm surprised it's a Gen Z. Yes, I know when I graduated and entered the workforce, I thought the same thing, and I'm certainly not Gen Z. I think it's, so it's not a new phenomena. But I guess I would say what someone told me when I asked when I was just new and starting out is, it's not what you learned in a book as an engineer. It's the way that you learned to think that we're looking for. How are you solving problems? And it's that thought process that is why you're an engineer, not what you read and memorized from the book. So if you think about some of these really great, exciting things we're talking about that are new and, you know, generational changes, you're not finding that in a book because it hasn't happened before. We're solving these problems for the first time in history. So yeah, you didn't learn that in school. You're not going to, and we didn't expect that you would, but you learned how to approach a problem, and that's what you learned in school. So I think that's what people have to get their head around, that none of us know how to do these things right out of the gate because they haven't been done before.
Well said, Kelly. Well said.
Very well said. Looks like we have maybe time for one question until we go to, we have a wrap-up question. This is a pretty specific question from Collins. What advice do you have for electronic engineers who would like to switch careers from, to the information technology sector?
Don't. No, of course, in all seriousness, that's a personal choice. But I think the electronics, again, electronics engineering is very, very exciting at the moment. If you think of the way in which computing is fundamentally changing, I think that that's an incredibly exciting area as well. And again, please excuse my advice based on the way I would think about problems. Kelly kind of mentioned this as well. When there's a lot of new, when there's a lot of change and disruption going on, I think that's the exciting area to be. Because things are changing so fast, you're learning at a rate of knots. And I would think in electronics, that's actually happening today in electronics as well. If you think of the kind of Moore's law, that idea that computing is kind of reaching its kind of doubling of transistors and cost at every quarter because computation is becoming harder, we're having to think of new forms of computers effectively. And electronic engineering is right in the heart of that work. That's in a very exciting area to be in, quantum computing, neuromorphic computing, non-Neumann architectures. So if I was starting my career, before I would think about moving, I'd really spend a bit of time thinking, why am I moving? And what is it in that career and about the career I'm in at the moment that makes me want to change? And I'd take a bit of a scan, call it an environmental scan, to look beyond or broadly across the industry, my in the fields, and to see areas that might excite me. for making that change. But of course, if you're going to make that change, I think that the tenets we were discussing would remain the same. Make sure to basically identify an area and be deliberate and focused on your training and development, because you will be starting from, you know, a kind of a, you'll be rebasing your skill level based on the industry or based on the discipline you're going into, and you're going to have to acquire a set of new skills as well.
Well, it looks like we are time for one of my favorite questions here. Can you all give the best piece of career advice that you've ever received as an engineer from your early career days or even more recently as a leader? So career advice is the question. Kelly, let's start with you.
Sure. So early in my career, I was had a mentor, and I was going into a new role. Like, I had just applied and been, you know, given an opportunity to move into a new position, and I was maybe second guessing whether or not I was qualified to be. Am I the best person for this new position? And my mentor at the time said that every time I take a new position, I should be equal parts excited and nervous. Because if I'm not nervous going into a position, then I'm not challenging myself. So, you know, if you're really trying to learn and get something out of this next role, it's okay to feel a little bit nervous and maybe second guessing, you know, because you have something to learn, and that's okay, right? That's actually important for us to be able to do that and put ourselves in those positions. And I mean, for me, that's something I always think about when I look at a new role or a new opportunity. I think I'm a little bit nervous, and then I remind myself, like, yeah, that's good. That's a good thing to feel.
Mark, in just a couple minutes.
I live by this mantra of you make and meet your commitments. So from early on, just make and meet your commitments, find ways to do that. And that becomes your call sign, your personal brand. Like, I think what Pradeep was saying as well. So mine has always been, I make and meet commitments. So I'll commit, when I commit to something, I fulsomely, wholeheartedly stick with it. I persevere to get whatever needs done. And that, in the hope that becomes, you know, my calling card, my moniker, my personal brand. And it's what drives me and propels me forward.
Brilliantly, sir.
A couple minutes we have left.
Yeah. For me, one early advice I received was ability to listen. We all hear, but do we listen? It's extremely important to practice that. It doesn't come easy. The second is ability to take feedback, right? We get perturbed, we get worked up, we start dismissing it, we say it's not me. Internalize feedback. It's feed forward. It's not back. It's actually feed forward. I think these are two things that I this is the feed forward I got, and I would advise this to anybody hearing the show.
Well, thank you, everyone. And thanks to everyone who took the time to be with us today. Thanks to our panelists, Kelly, Mark, and Pradeep, for a really engaging, insightful conversation. I also want to thank the commenters for putting in so many questions. I wish we had time to address all of them today. As promised, if any of you are interested in learning more about Eaton's engineering opportunities, visit eaton.com/careers. And with that, we will draw our LinkedIn Live event to a close.